In this video, we will discuss continuous probability distributions. The first part we will look at is dealing with uniform probability distributions. Uniform probability distributions are distributions in that have the same probability no matter what information you're talking about. They're most commonly used if you're dealing with something over time. So, like if you were to call a hotline and they told you that the wait time is uniformly distributed, that means that the probability you wait 10 minutes for someone to pick up your call is the same as the probability that it takes, I don't know, 12 minutes, 13 minutes, etc. The probability distribution, so the main probability, comes from 1 over b minus a, where b is the upper bound and a is the lower bound. To get the mean of this distribution, that's equal to a plus b, in other words, your lower plus your higher, divided by 2. And this is also called the mid-range. Essentially, you're just finding the halfway point between your lower and upper bound. So let's go ahead and look at an example here. A realtor is interested to find out some information about how many days it takes to go into closing once in contract if a bank loan is needed. She finds it takes between 30 and 60 days. Suppose the closing time is uniformly distributed. Now, the only reason we are allowed to use the uniform distribution is because they're specifying here that this is a uniform distribution. Now, one thing that you're going to want to remember, no matter what type of continuous probability distribution you're dealing with, is that if you know what the picture looks like, the probability is just the area under the curve. Because this is uniform, it takes on the shape of a rectangle. And let me explain why. Your lower bound, we said, was 60, your upper bound, I'm sorry, I said that backwards. Your lower bound is 30, your upper bound being 60. The height of the rectangle is that P of X thing that we described on the previous page, and that is 1 over B minus A. 1 over 60 minus 30 is 30. So the height of this is 1/30. Now, what this is telling us, again, no matter where on here you look, the probability is the height of this rectangle. So the probabilities are equal no matter what amount of time passes, whether it's 32 days or 47 days, those all have the same probability of occurring. What is the mean amount of days it takes to close? Well, we said that that was the low plus the high, so we have 30 plus 60, divide by 2, which gives us 45. So the mean closing time is 45 days in this situation. Now, if you wanted to get a little bit more specific and pick, let's say, you know, more than a certain amount of days between a certain number of days, you can also find the probability of that. If they're asking us here more than 50 days, what's the probability it takes more than 50 days to close? Well, think again about that picture, right? If we look at where 50 falls on the picture, it's right about there. More than 50 is anything from 50 up to 60. We can't exceed 60 because they said this was only uniformly distributed from 30 to 60 days. So what's the probability of that occurring? Fill in what you already know. Well, the probability of more than 50 days means that X is greater than 50. Now, if you recall from the last chapter, we said X is our random variable. It doesn't matter if you're dealing with discrete variables or random variables, you can still use X regardless of which you're in. Earlier, we also said that the probability is the area under the curve. Well, this is a rectangle, and by cutting this section here, what's our shaded region? It's another rectangle. The width of the rectangle from 50 to 60, that is 10 units, and the height is 1/30. How do you find the area of a rectangle? Length times width. So you have 10 times 1 over 30, which is 10 over 30, and go ahead and reduce it. That is 1/3, or if you wish, you can round that to 3 decimal places. In addition to uniform distributions, we're also going to begin investigating normal distributions. This is something that will pretty much carry us through the remainder of the semester because normal distributions are the key component to everything else that we're going to do. We said at the beginning of the course that something is approximately normal if it follows roughly the bell curve. And that means that it is symmetric around the mean. Now, although we've said that things can be normal, you've probably heard the phrase approximately normal at this point of the course, but one thing that we will deal with in particular is called the standard normal distribution. The standard normal distribution is quite special to us because using this table, which if you look at over here, you'll notice standard normal probability table. The standard normal curve is something which we already have the probabilities associated with. Now, you could go ahead and find probabilities for something that does not follow the standard normal curve, the standard normal distribution. However, if you already have this table, then it's just a matter of converting things over, and I'll explain that. So, for something to be standard normal, the standard normal distribution has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1, which, if you think about your empirical rule for a moment, we talked about back in chapter 3, we set that up and we said, in the center it was a number line. If we went one standard deviation to the right, that was 1 sigma. And although we didn't call it that, we said the mean was in the center and that was 0. So then we had 1, 2, 3, and then of course symmetric. So on the left it was negative 1, negative 2, and negative 3. So I want you to consider this as we move forward. How do you go ahead and calculate probabilities? Well, what this table over here does is you'll notice the z going on. These are all z-scores. Everything associated with this table, which is front and back, you'll see one is the positive z-scores, the other side is the negative z-scores. If you know the z-score, then you can find the probability without any huge amount of work. Now, remember your z-score formula. Go ahead, that's x minus your mean divided by the standard deviation. Again, once you have this z-score, it's just a matter of usually addition or subtraction. Let's look at an example. The distribution of monthly charges for cell phone plans in the US are approximately normal with a mean of $62 and a standard deviation of 18. What percentage, notice here they say percentage, but if you were asked for the probability, that's just telling you how to write your final answer. What percentage of plans have charges that are less than $83.65? Well, before you go and do anything crazy, copy down what we know. We know that the mean is $62 with a standard deviation of $18. They also said that this was approximately normal. Because this is approximately normal, well, what do we know about the normal curve? It follows that bell shape. So we're not grading on your art skills here, but if you know what that picture looks like, you know what to look for. Okay, in the center, I'm going to plot my mean. And then they asked us what percent of plans have charges that are less than 83.60. That right there is asking us to find the probability that X is less than 83.65. Well, where does 83.65 fall on here? 62 is in the center. We go from low to high. So it's probably over here somewhere. Because they're asking us for less than is going to be to the left of that line that we just drew. So let's just fill in the rest of what we know. Now, we know what the picture looks like, so we're looking for this area here. Well, every little bit in this chart, although we're not quite there yet, see all these decimal values in the center? Those are all probabilities or areas. So again, if you know that z-score, if you know what the picture looks like, then you're just finding the area under the curve. So when we plug into our z-score formula, we get 83.65 minus 62, all divided by 18. Which numerator first, then we divide, gives us 1.20. Remember here in chapter 4, or I'm sorry, chapter 3, you were told to always round z-scores to two decimal places. This table is the reason why. Once you have this z-score and you've determined if it's positive or negative, go to your chart. We're going to have to flip this over because we are on the positive side. And you'll notice up top they're showing you the shaded region. So they're showing you what this looks like. That looks just like our picture, the way it's shaded. What you do on the left, this is where you get your ones place and tens place. You're going to go down to 1.2, which is right here. And then across the top, you want to find where that intersects with your hundredths place. And again, this is why we needed to round to two places. So you go down to 1.20, and we get an area of 0.8849. So this is telling us that the area is 0.8849. In other words, the area under the curve here that we shaded in is 0.8849, which is approximately 88.49%. So in the context of this problem, what percent of plants have charges that are less than 83.65? They're saying, according to this, about 88.49% of people are paying less than 83.65. We will return momentarily with the next couple examples.